today, everybody, to talk about the challenges that you're facing in your communities and your lives and how the pandemic's affected you and the changes that government, my government, has brought in and the changes you'd like to see in the next number of months and the next number of years. Michelle, what's on your mind? What are the things that matter most to you?
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm 25 years old. I'm original from Venezuela. And I came to Canada about 7 years ago. It's a beautiful country. I came to Vancouver specifically, and I just realized the cost of living, it was quite expensive. However, I'm very grateful the fact that BC NDP government is actually being able to remove all the cost of MSP. As I developed some like health issues during the time, it was quite difficult to afford health medical care.
Yeah.
So therefore, I'm always going to be super grateful. I'm also very grateful that they remove all the bridge tools.
So you can move around.
Yes, and I can move around because I kind of like work everywhere, so I have to go back and forth, and it was quite expensive.
Yeah.
And right now with the pandemic of COVID, I think all families have faced a big challenge. So I'm super, super happy the fact that I'm here in BC, because besides the emergency for the government, here in Vancouver, we were able to receive $1,000, which, believe me, it was very helpful.
Yeah.
It released a lot of cost of my expenses. I support my family. They're not here in Canada, but I do have to look after them. So I'm super, super blessed that I'm here with this government, which is amazing. And I also opened my new business, thanks to all the financial release.
Yes.
So I'm very grateful. So I think overall that I want to say that if we have a government that is helping our families and friends, and is looking after us, and you know, is supporting the community, I think this is the government that I want to support, and we should all support.
Well, thanks very much for that, Michelle. See, it's not that difficult to tell your story, to talk about the changes that have happened in your life that make it a little bit easier during these difficult times. So thanks very much for sharing that with us.
Thank you.
Alvin, you've got a story to tell as well.
Yes. So I'm 27. I have a business degree. After getting my degree, I went straight to the corporate world. During March, when COVID hit like dramatically, I watched our sales like sank. Within that same week, I was laid off. On the next week, my mom was laid off, my dad was laid off. So my family was hit pretty hard from it. So when they introduced the BC emergency benefit, you know, it really helped our family because it felt like we had like a safety net. So yeah, I really appreciate that.
Yeah. It makes a difference when government's looking out for people, right? Starting to focus on those that need the help.
Yeah.
You've got a business degree, you're intelligent, you're thoughtful,
yeah.
And the COVID pandemic affected you and your family. It didn't discriminate, it didn't select the wealthier or the poor, it hit everyone equally. And so government should be there for you to lift you up and give you the opportunity to go from there. And things have turned around, things are starting to look a little bit more bright on the future.
Yeah. Yes. Well, where my whole family got rehired, so
excellent.
definitely helped. Yeah.
But to have that bridge from uncertainty to get back to a place where you can continue to build full and rich lives here in British Columbia, that's what government's supposed to do,
mm-hmm.
to be there for people when they need it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, Alvin. Marcelina, tell us about your challenges.
Yes.
As a retired childcare worker and with your husband still at work.
Yes, my name is Marcelina, and I will be 65 in December. And my throat, it's that's now the effect of my puffer, that okay. Because I've been diagnosed with COPD in 2016.
Yeah.
So I have to have my puffer, which will make me normal for the day and work. And that's the reason why I would like the MSP. Thank you for the MSP, and I would like drugs, like prescription drugs, to be affordable for us.
So a national pharmacare program that benefits all Canadians, as we do with our public health care, is just the sort of program you and your family are looking for.
That's
correct.
You're
dependent on the puffers. You need to have them. It's not a nice to have. It's important to your quality of life and your well-being.
Yeah.
And your husband's still working, so
and
you can
I would
get
like
the benefits.
My husband to retire as well. He's 66. He's still working.
Yeah.
Because of the medication that we have.
Yeah. And you had other plans.
Yes, we had plans.
Enjoy your senior years together, not with one working so you could pay for the prescriptions that you needed, but to enjoy British Columbia and all that it has to offer.
Yeah, yes.
Well, thank you for sharing that. And thank you, families, for being here to get us started on the rest of the day. So I'm going to go to the microphone and do my work. Does that sound like a good idea? Okay. Good morning, everybody. I'm seeing a lot of people on the screen here. Welcome, candidates, to the launch of our platform for 2020. We're here on the traditional territory of the Squamish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh First Nations, and I'm very grateful to Michelle, Alvin, and Marcelina for sharing their stories to get us started on the challenges that they faced during the pandemic and what they want to see in their future. We all know that COVID-19 has challenged and changed British Columbia. People are looking to a future that is uncertain. They're looking to a future that they just don't know where to turn. They want to ensure that their government is focused on them. Today we're launching our Working for You platform for the coming 4 years, and it lays out a vision for British Columbia that focuses on people and the services that they need to make sure that we come out of the pandemic stronger than we went in. Andrew Wilkinson and the BC Liberals want to take us backwards. They want to take us back to a time when government focused on the wealthy and the well-connected and cut services for people. They looked at tax breaks for those who needed them least and forgot about those that needed help the most. His plan put the biggest benefits where they weren't necessary. I want to focus on the people that are here today and other British Columbians that are looking forward to a government that continues to focus on their needs now and into the future. Mr. Wilkinson's plan would call for higher costs for people, whether it be back to the old days of medical services premiums, high car insurance costs, hydro rates, tolls on bridges, and on it would go. And to pay for their plan, they want to cut services like health care and child care, so critically important to British Columbians at this time. We can't afford to go back. We need to make sure that we have a government that faces the problems of today and takes them on squarely with the purpose of making life better for all British Columbians. 16 years of BC Liberal neglect created a number of problems, and we're committed to solving them. Our plan today is guided by 4 basic principles. Principles that will help us create a province that we want now and in the future. Firstly, a more affordable province for everyone. Lasting and meaningful reconciliation with Indigenous people. A better future through fighting climate change. And ensuring that workers and small businesses are put at the front of our economic recovery. Our plan will build on where we are with stronger services for people, always making sure that their needs are met where they live and when they need them. And we'll meet this challenge by focusing on getting to zero emissions with respect to our climate action plan by 2050, always working with Indigenous peoples to ensure that everyone in British Columbia benefits from the bounty and wealth and wisdom and innovation of our people. Today's platform includes 154 commitments, 60 which are brand new, the rest building on the work that we've already started. We have 3 basic priorities. Better health care for you and your family, affordability and security in your home and in your community, and good jobs and livelihoods in a clean energy future. Universal public health care is what defines us as British Columbians and Canadians. It has never been more important than during COVID-19. To improve health care for you and your family, we want to make sure that we're delivering faster, better health care closer to home. That means continuing with more hospitals, more urgent primary care centres and diagnostics. And we'll launch BC's 2nd medical school to train doctors, nurses, nurse practitioners and other health care providers right here in BC. We'll also make BC a leader, as they have been, in cancer care by launching a 10-year cancer care action plan. And it will include more individual care and more resources invested in treatment and research. The BC Cancer Agency is renowned. We want to make sure that the next 10 years take us to the next level with respect to making sure that people who are afflicted with cancer have the services that they need, and the researchers that are here in British Columbia have the tools to make breakthroughs as they've been doing over the past number of years. And we will also, of course, as we've said during the campaign to this point, be investing significantly in long-term care and home care for seniors so they can be safe and healthy and live their final years in dignity. And that's, of course, what they deserve. We'll also build on the hiring of 7,000 new frontline healthcare workers to make sure our seniors are safe, giving opportunities to those who've been displaced by COVID-19 so they can build a new future and a new career right here in their own community. And with Marcelina in mind, we'll continue to fight and make sure the federal government is focused on a national pharmacare plan so we can bring down the cost of pharmaceuticals to make life more affordable for British Columbians. For the past 3 years, we've worked hard to make our homes and our neighborhoods more affordable and safer. But there's much more work to do. Our plan provides a one-time $1,000 recovery benefit to help families and $500 for individuals. We'll make life more affordable by freezing rents into 2021 and capping rent increases to the cost of inflation. We'll also help families with children by expanding our $10 a day childcare plan and ensuring that transit is free for kids under 12. Right there. These new initiatives will build on the progress we've already made. And we'll continue with our housing plan, which has already seen 25,000 affordable homes either built or underway. And we'll continue to expand our transit options to growing areas of British Columbia, cutting ICBC premiums by up to 20%, and making sure that everyone benefits from moving around in British Columbia without tolls, without costs. We're going to try and make sure those costs are as low as they possibly can be, connecting communities through the Lower Mainland and throughout British Columbia. And as we recover, now is the time, in my opinion and the opinion of my colleagues, that we build an economic recovery that works for everyone. Instead of tax cuts that benefit the top 1% of British Columbians, our plan will take 1% of GDP and put it into a new recovery investment fund. This $3 billion fund will be above and beyond the $23 billion we're already spending on capital projects and infrastructure, so we can build more schools, more hospitals, more transit, more childcare spaces, and all of the other things British Columbia needs to meet our full potential. This plan will create 18,000 jobs a year and put people back to work who've been affected by COVID-19. We'll also move to our country-leading climate action plan. And I want to take a moment to thank Dr. Weaver and the Green Caucus for working with the BC NDP to have the strongest climate action plan in North America. But there's much more to do. We need to build on that by investing in creative new technologies and making sure we're training the next generation of scientists and engineers to build that future in a safe, environmentally sustainable way. And that means training people here in British Columbia to take on the challenges, not just here, but internationally. We have been world leaders. We need to continue being world leaders. You don't do that by closing doors on people. You do that by opening up the doors of opportunity. Our plan also provides for small and medium-sized businesses to get the grants that they need to protect over 200,000 jobs. That's building on the Stronger BC plan, the economic strategy that we announced last month. And of course, hard-hit tourism operators will have a special opportunity to top up those grants in communities right across British Columbia. The challenges we face over the next 4 years are profound. I believe we need a strong, stable government to focus on the needs of British Columbia, the needs of the people of this great province. The question British Columbians have to ask themselves over the next 2 weeks is, where do they want to go and who do they want to lead them? I believe our plan puts people squarely in the driver's seat. British Columbians are my highest priority each and every day. I'm always focused and have been in my entire time in the legislature, and certainly having had the privilege of being the premier for the past 3.5 years, I've always focused on making sure that those without voice, those without the wherewithal to buy what they need, have a government that's focused on them. The BC Liberals have another approach. The wealthy and the well-connected are what they focus on. That's not for me. I believe that British Columbians deserve a government that gets up every day working for them. That's what I'm offering today, and I want to thank people for dialing in. I want to thank my friends for joining me here today to get the message out that BC is people, the economy is people. It's as simple as that. If we focus on each other, we lift each other up, we'll be better off after this pandemic gets past us. Thanks very much, and I think Jen is going to take some questions.
Thank you very much. Reminder to reporters on the line, please press star one to enter the queue. We're going to start today with a question from Binder Sajjan.
Hi, John. So I'm looking at the costing for your platform, and you're anticipating that this would hit around $15 billion in the first year. Is that correct? And just wondering, you know, some governments have decided to go even larger into the deficit area, wondering why you're not considering going, I guess, even bigger with the deficit.
Well, thank you, Binder. And I've been, this is my, I think, fifth election campaign. They're starting to blur together. And never has there been a time when a journalist has asked me, how come you're not going further into deficit? So that speaks, I think, to the extraordinary times that we live in. British Columbia's budget was balanced in February. It was balanced for the next 3 years. We had the fastest rate of economic growth, the lowest unemployment rate. We were the envy of the country. And it's because of that strong fiscal position and the work of Carol James and our team to keep our finances in order while we expanded the services that people need that's allowed us to have our economic recovery start with the $6 billion that we announced while we were in government, adding again additional resources here to lift the budget deficit for this year to about $15 billion. In addition to that, of course, is an additional $3 billion for capital, not this year, next year, and the year after that, for a total of $9 billion in more. That means more schools, more bridges, more transit, more opportunities for work. I believe that this is a safe investment for British Columbians. It's thoughtful. We haven't been reckless about this. We understand that when this is over, we're going to have to dig out from underneath it. I believe these investments will create opportunity for people and allow us to deliver the services that are so important to British Columbians.
Binder, do you have a follow-up?
Yeah, I'm just wondering, as looking at through some of these new promises, some of them seem to be from the Liberals. If I look at the pay equity transparency that you're promising, if I'm looking at childcare being brought into the Ministry of Education, I know that, you know, with the minority government, you weren't able to do all those things, but have you borrowed here from other parties? And do you believe that, why do you believe now is the time to do it when these are some of the things that you rejected previously?
Well, I find it inconceivable that these would be Liberal ideas. The BC Liberals were in government for 16 years and they did not advance childcare. They did not advance pay equity, did not advance any of the issues that are contained in this platform. I'm humbled that, you know, imitation is the highest form of flattery. If the Liberals want to imitate the ideas that we're bringing forward and have been implementing for the past 3.5 years, good for them. It's nice that they're catching up now. But they had a decade and a half to make life better for British Columbians and they went in the opposite direction.
Our next question is from Rob Shaw.
Well, hey, Premier, can you explain the rationale in giving people, you know, essentially cash at this point in the pandemic recovery? There have been other aid packages. Like, what is the hope that that will do for people and for the economy?
Well, the package will cost about $1.4 billion, and that's putting dollars right into the pockets of those families that need it the most. This is for people with a family income of $125,000 or individuals with an income of about $62,500 a year. I believe those are the people that are struggling right now. Those are the people that need to have those extra dollars to make sure that they can get by, not just through this pandemic, but into the recovery period. I think this is a good investment in people. They'll not put this in tax havens in the Grand Caymans like those that are looking at BC Liberal tax cut proposals. They'll put this money right back into the community, investing in small businesses, making purchases that will stimulate other economic activity. I think this is prudent economics, and it makes sense right now, particularly as we come through COVID-19. We're far from out of the woods. These dollars will be important to the families that are here today and families right across British Columbia.
Rob, do you have a follow-up?
Yeah, thanks. Going back to the costing of it, I noticed that, I guess, you as a party, but also as a government, can't even begin to project what next year's finances are going to be for the province. There's no deficit projection, there's no revenue projections, there's no sense of this. So if the deficit continues to worsen and you're still spending about $2 billion a year on these extra platform promises, is that going to be acceptable in your view with a higher deficit number possible next year?
Well, I go back to Binder's question, Rob. Why aren't you spending more? And that's a legitimate question. I'm not being dismissive, Binder. I absolutely understand where you're coming from. We believe this is prudent. We believe this puts the stimulus in the hands of the people who need it the most. The economic recovery involves building out British Columbia, connecting people and communities. That's what we're going to be focusing on. And if this is, as I said, when Carol and I announced the stimulus package back in March and the economic recovery stronger BC last month. If this isn't sufficient to meet our challenges going forward, we'll make additional investments. But our fiscal situation is so solid here in British Columbia, we've got a lot of space to make these choices that other provinces and other jurisdictions around the world, quite frankly, don't have. We don't want to be reckless. We want British Columbians to know that we've got their backs. We also want them to know that we're not just throwing money to try and buy votes. We're throwing money at people to stimulate economic activity, to keep them safe, and to build the services that people need. Investing in urgent primary care centers, more hospitals, cancer care, training doctors and nurse practitioners right here in British Columbia to meet the deficit in health care providers that the BC Liberals left to us. They had 15 years to figure this out. They squandered that time. We're playing catch-up in the midst of a global pandemic, but I'm proud of the work we've done, and I can't wait to get going on the work we need to do.
Our next question today is from Richard Zisman.
On the up to $1,000 deposit for British Columbians, when did you come up with this idea, and did you hold it out of the economic recovery plan that was announced just a few days before for the election in order to save it for the platform?
Well, we've been thinking about what the needs of British Columbians for 3.5 years since the last election. And we've been bringing forward ideas in each budget. In the minority government, we have to work with our partners and in the confidence and supply agreement to come up with things that they were prepared to support. We believe an election campaign is the time to put forward ideas and ask British Columbians what they think of those ideas. I believe that looking at what the former government, the BC Liberals, offered up, tax cuts across the board, tax cuts that would help only the wealthy. If you wanted to buy a yacht, the BC Liberals are your team. For us, it was about getting money into people's pockets so they could make those expenditures in communities to stimulate more economic activity, to keep small retailers going, to keep restaurants going, to have a few bucks in your pocket, to go out and buy a meal every now and again. I think that's what British Columbians want to see from their government, especially during this time of CERB and the emergency benefit that Alvin benefited from in our previous plan. The success of that plan made us feel that this was the right way to go. Putting this forward now is appropriate, and I know British Columbians are anxious to have the resources. We're going to get them to them as quickly as possible.
Richard, do you have a follow-up?
I will ask again. Did you decide on this before the election and hold it out of the plan, considering that people could be getting this money now if not receiving it for a fancy-looking election platform promise?
We did not contemplate this until we were putting together the platform, which was not until after the election was called. We put this together over the past couple of weeks based on what we see as the needs of British Columbians, and I believe it's appropriate, and British Columbians will respond positively to it.
Our next question is from Justin McElroy.
Hi, John. A question about the rent freeze promised for 2021. It was just a month ago that you dropped the maximum allowable rent increase for next year to just 1.4%. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering how this would work for people who have already been locked into that lease for the next year.
Well, those leases have been agreed to, and they will be binding on the landlords and the tenants. This freeze will go into next year. It will be every increase after that will be held to the rate of inflation. There will be provisions for investments in suites and units, receipts, and all of that will be recouped through other mechanisms within the Residential Tenancy Act. I believe this is an appropriate way to go when housing uncertainty is at its highest, I think, in BC history with the pandemic. I think it's appropriate we keep people in place. Good tenants are hard to come by. Good landlords are hard to come by. I believe the vast majority of those people are finding each other, and that benefits everybody.
Justin, do you have a follow-up?
I do. On the platform point of saying we'll work with communities to complete the SkyTrain expansion project to Langley, does that mean that your government is fully committing to spending the approximately $600 or $700 million when you look at previous funding models for the expansion from Fleetwood to Langley City? And why is there nothing about the UBC line extension in there as well?
Well, we're waiting for phase three of the SkyTrain plan or the rapid transit plan to come from TransLink and the Mayor's Council. We believe sending the signal that we want to get to Langley. That's where the fast-growing populations are that need to get back into the city. Getting out to Arbutus is the first priority here in Vancouver, and then extending on to UBC will be the next phase, and we'll await that to come from the Mayor's Council after we get started on phase two.
Our next question is from Lisa Yuzda.
Hi there, Premier. I'm wondering, with schools, and you've heard the concerns that parents and families are having, if you are reelected, what would you do to improve the situation? There are parents feeling, and I'm sure you've heard it, very unsure that they're not getting the communication they need, that they don't feel like they're having a voice in how this plan is rolling out with COVID in schools. What would you do to improve that situation, to improve the communication, and to improve their confidence in what's happening?
Now that the school year is underway, families are in touch with the schools that their kids are in. They're able to talk to the administrators, the principals and vice principals. The superintendents in districts right across British Columbia are looking at any of the challenges that they may have, whether it be with communication or other concerns in classrooms. And we have in place advisory groups of teachers, support workers, parents, as well as the Ministry of Education. We worked very, very hard to make sure everyone had a say, but that doesn't end with the beginning of the school year. I've said from the beginning, Lisa, this is about making sure that we continue to develop the best plan possible, and that's by getting new information and then adjusting and acting on that new information. So for those parents who are concerned, their first course of action is to talk to the principal and the administrators in their school, make sure that they have all the information that they need, and be confident that public health officials have always had a plan for sicknesses in schools. Pre-pandemic, we've redoubled those efforts. We put a whole bunch of money, about $270 million into making sure that kids are safe and that teachers have the equipment they need and the space in classrooms to provide a quality education through one of the most challenging times any of us could have imagined. Is it perfect? Certainly not. But we're going to work every day to do what we can to make it so.
Do you have a follow-up, Lisa?
Yes, I'm asking what you would do. I assure you that parents have done those things. They have talked to their superintendent. They have talked to health, and they are not feeling like they are hearing what they need. There are schools that are feeling that they are not getting what they need. The BCTF out today with a survey of teachers saying that they're still not getting what they need. There's a breakdown when it comes to superintendents and school districts giving schools what they need, and there's not enough oversight is what we're hearing. So what will you do to make sure that happens? We have not been able to get a hold of the Ministry of Education. I understand there's a caretaker government, but there was a lot of challenges before the election was called getting these answers from the minister.
Again, local districts are autonomous. They deliver the services to families. They make sure kids are safe. They're there with teachers, with support staff, doing their level best to make sure communication is what it needs to be within the community. I'm sure everyone is working as hard as they can. No one is sleepwalking through this extraordinary time. If there's more resources needed, they'll be available. I believe that communication has to continue each and every day. If you don't get the answer you want on Tuesday, you should ask again on Wednesday. And I'm not saying that this is a perfect situation. Everyone understands that. But why we are where we are in British Columbia right now, leading the country in our response to COVID-19, is because people have been tolerant and focused on working together to find the solutions that all of us need. We need to keep going on that. We need to focus on the fact that we're not in this by ourselves. We're all in this together.
Our next question is from Matt Preprost.
Hi, good morning, Mr. Horgan. If reelected, will you commit to ending the provincial state of emergency and managing the pandemic without it? And will you commit to a winter and spring sitting of the legislature? Thank you.
Well, on this, the latter, there are fixed calendars for the legislature. We've adhered to that. I spent 12 interminable years in opposition calling on the BC Liberals to have a fixed calendar. Sometimes they did, sometimes they didn't. I believe that it's important for the legislature to sit several times a year. I know that there will be 87 people elected on the 24th of October, all of them wanting to get to work right away. I'm committed to that. With respect to the state of emergency, that's in the hands of the situation we find ourselves in. Provinces across the country remain in the same place we are. We have professional government workers, professional public servants who are working every day to make sure British Columbians are safe. That has always been the case, and I'm confident that we'll continue through that until such time as we can lift the state of emergency and get back to something resembling normal. But British Columbians have responded well to guidance and to the restrictions that we put in place, and it's benefited us all.
Matt, do you have a follow-up?
Yes, one quick question here about Site C. River diversion was achieved on the weekend, according to BC Hydro, yet there's still ongoing concerns about the geological problems on the south bank of the river, with reports that the foundation for the spillway and generating station is slipping some 70 feet into the Peace River Gumbo. Is it prudent to continue with Site C at this time?
I'm not familiar with the assertions you just made. What I do know is that when there was concerns about stability on the bank, we appointed an engineer, a former deputy minister of highways, a former deputy minister of finance, to look at the situation independently and report back to government. I understand that work is underway. I'll have a better opportunity to answer that question when I've seen that work.
Our next question is from Andrew McLeod.
Yeah, hi, Horgan. You're promising a new medical school. I'm wondering if you could provide a little more detail on that, like where you're thinking and how many doctors and other health professionals a year you're thinking.
Well, what we're looking, we're going to be talking to all of the post-secondary institutions in British Columbia to see where the best fit would be. Certainly, I believe the best course of action would be to make sure we're close to hospitals, mostly in the Lower Mainland, I would suspect. We already have some seats at UMBC in Prince George. There's some medical teaching being done at UVic as well. UBC, of course, is the center, the hub. And I think a hub and spoke model is going to be the best way forward. Adrian Dix has been working on this for some time. He'd be in a better position to answer the details about this, but what I do know is the former government did not invest in training the next generation of healthcare workers. They had a program called a GP for Me that was a great bumper sticker, but did nothing to bring healthcare closer to people. We've been focused on urgent primary care centers and, most importantly, a primary care network within communities across BC that connect the diverse healthcare providers, whether they be doctors, nurses, nurse practitioners, dietitians, social workers, therapists, bringing them all together so that when patients come to a clinic or come to an emergency room, if they haven't been attached to a doctor, they can connect to the provider that they need. That's a step in the right direction. But what we've discovered, and Adrian's been leading on this, is that we don't have enough trained healthcare providers to provide the services that British Columbians expect and, quite frankly, should be demanding. The Liberals failed on this regard, and we're going to do our level best to succeed.
Andrew, do you have a follow-up?
Yeah, sure. On an unrelated topic, the rent supplement promise this time has some significant differences from the rent supplement you promised last time around. I'm wondering if you could talk about those changes and why they were important to make.
Well, we've always felt that a renter's rebate was an appropriate way to go forward. We already have, for homeowners, the homeowner grants, which is a money given back to homeowners just for the privilege of owning a home. It helps with their property taxes. It helps with the improvements on their home. Renters should have access to public dollars as well. We looked at it, and we felt that having a means test was an appropriate way to go forward. Many people who are renting don't require an additional break. They have a significant income or sufficient income to meet their needs. So we wanted to focus this, as we have with other initiatives in this platform, on the people who need it the most. And I believe the time has arrived to make sure that all British Columbians, wherever they live, in their own home, in a condominium that they own or they're renting, should have a break on those costs. And that's what Working for You is all about, making sure that we're reducing costs for people in their communities and in their homes.
Our last questions today are from Shannon Waters.
Good morning. I wanted to follow up on the commitment that is framed as new, which is to fast-track decriminalization by working with police chiefs. I believe that's something you've committed to before. So why is it considered new in the platform?
Because we have reiterated with the federal government that we want to see some action. There hasn't been any action. This platform commitment renews that initiative. We're working with a range of issues brought forward largely by Dr. Henry with respect to prescription alternatives. We need more treatment. We need more opportunities to help people when they fall into addictions, whether they have mental health issues as well. We made great progress by being the only province in 2017 to have a standalone minister who got up every day focusing on these issues. We've made an appeal to the federal government. I'm hopeful that they will act. One of our first orders of business in 2017 was to advise law enforcement across British Columbia that we were not interested in prosecuting simple possession. But the criminal code is not our responsibility, it's a federal responsibility. This platform commits the next government, if it's led by me, to ensuring that the federal government follows through on this pledge that I've made to British Columbians.
Shannon, do you have a follow-up?
I do. I'm wondering about this complex care proposal and whether it seems to suggest that you're looking at reopening Riverview, and I'm wondering what that would look like.
Well, the Riverview lands have been a focus of discussion within my government since 2017. Selena Robinson is her community. She's been the Minister of Housing. We've been working with mental health and addictions, with the Ministry of Health, with Housing, BC Housing, to see what we can do about using those lands as the community wants, as a refuge for those vulnerable in the community, those with addictions, those with mental health challenges. So the Riverview lands are a key part of our complex care solution, and we'll have more to say about that following consultation with the community, which has been going on for a couple of years now. But what I'm heartened by is that the council in Coquitlam has said to the province, we want to help vulnerable people. This is a good place to do it. And with that type of collaboration and cooperation, there's nothing we can't do as British Columbians. We have significant challenges ahead of us. As British Columbians, we should not be worrying about jurisdiction. When I think of salmon, for example, talking to Governor Jay Inslee in Washington State, he and I both know that the salmon oftentimes dip their tail into U.S. waters, and the federal government declares that salmon are their responsibility. The bears don't know that. The eagles don't know that. Indigenous people don't care about that. And most importantly, the salmon don't care about that. I think we need governments that focus on the challenges at hand. Let's get the jurisdictional squabbles up on the table and work through them. I'd like to think that I've spent the past 3.5 years working with anyone who wants to work with me. These challenges are not simple, but they need focus and they need attention and they need a stable government for the next 4 years.
Thank you, everyone. That's all the time we have.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, guys.